$6 in my hand. Up to Lexington, 125. Feel sick and dirty, more dead than alive. I'm waiting for my man. Hey, white boy, what you doing uptown? Hey, white boy, you chasing all women around. Oh, pardon me, sir, it's furthest from my mind. I'm just looking forward to dear friend of mine.
This is Another Music in a Different Kitchen, and with us this morning we've got John from the Proles.
Good morning.
Great to have you with us, John.
Thanks, cheers.
What I normally try and do is to put it all into perspective, and what I mean by that is like taking you right back to, say, like pre-punk.
Yeah.
And if you give us a little bit of life in fence houses in the early 70s and how that life generated into you being involved in the punk scene.
Right. Fence houses, like most pit villages, not a lot to do. Although there's probably more to do then than there is now, unfortunately. There was the YMCA, you had your dance on a Friday night, you know, sixpence at the door, that was it. And I think going there from about the age of 11 with my friends, we started to develop a liking for loud music, because it was loud. You'd never heard that before at home, all you had was your telly and your radio. So you start to become discerning about the type of music you like. So by the age of about, I mean, let's see, 1970, I would have been about 11. So 71, 72, you're starting to get T-Rex, stuff like that. It's sort of rockier side of pop, which we enjoyed, you know, Slade. And then Bowie came along. I should say Bowie, give me his pronoun. So that's what the Scots call him, Bowie. Bowie. So he came along and I developed a passion for his music, the Ziggy Stardust era. So I would have been about 14, 15 then. And Peter, my friend at school, we'd been to school since we were like five together. He was the same, and we actually got tickets just for the Aladdin Sane tour June the 8th, 1973. And it was one of those sort of epiphany moments.
Yeah, I was just going to say, pivotal moment.
We were eight rows from the front, you know, and we didn't know what to expect. We'd never been to a gig in our lives, you know. Never seen a proper guitar before. And of course the lights went down, they started with the Beethoven's Ninth Symphony and all this, and then they came on, Hang On To Yourself, and I was sold. This is just the most amazing thing I've seen in my entire life. After that, I think the next gig we did was Lou Reed. That would have been sort of like Rock and Roll Animal tour, you know. And of course, with Bowie being a huge, I think the thing that David Bowie did for a lot of young people was open windows and doors to different things that you would never have thought of, like the Velvet Underground, Iggy and the Stooges, you know.
I've heard that many times. Yeah. The way he introduced you to, like you say, the likes of Iggy and
they were so much more interesting to the likes of me and Peter than the likes of Deep Purple and Black Sabbath and Led Zeppelin, although I'll be honest with you, I have listened to them since, you know.
As a guitarist.
As a guitarist, yeah, obviously. But they just had that, being the type of kid at school who was never what you'd call popular, you know, never been one of the in crowd, Peter wasn't really. We sort of fell into that, yeah, there is an alternative. You do not have to conform to the sort of fake plastic, because we used to be always going about other people's fake laughs, and, you know, in the small groups. You'd get groups of lads together and somebody would say something and others would laugh because that person was cool, you know. And we just like, no, that's not honest, it's not real. So we had our own thing, basically, that was it. So we got jobs, we left school, probably saw a lot more bands. I'm trying to think who we would have seen. Mick Ronson, I remember seeing Mick Ronson early on in his solo tour, the only one he ever did.
Where would you go for gigs? Would it normally
City Hall,
be Newcastle? Yeah,
City Hall was like Mecca for gigs, you know. So lost my train of thought there. Yeah, so left school, got jobs, and the first thing on me sort of apprentice wage of, you know, £10.46 a week, buy a guitar. So I'll be at the Bell's catalogue out. Right? How much is it going to cost a week? Or send away for it, and I sent away for an Avon SG bass, copy bass. It was like £35. Peter got a Zenta Telecaster, I remember, and the other Kevin, he got a Columbus Les Paul, and we sort of, you know, we struggled on a bit. I tell you what was a big help at the time, the New Musical Express, the NME, did a thing called the Guitar Book, and they showed you some basic chords.
Right.
And I still think to this day that that was instrumental in a lot of people picking up a guitar around about 75, 76 that wouldn't have, because the NME was the Bible if you saw yourself as an out there type of guy.
Yeah.
You know, if you weren't going to be like everybody else.
Hear the news. Like.
And, I mean, Charles Shaw, Murray Brightons like that, like these other people opened our minds. We were like CSE type guys, you know. We weren't your O level, A level students, right. So we were obviously just going to get if we were lucky, we were going to get craft apprenticeships, and that would have been it. But there was always that, like, it sounds pretentious, that intellectual longing, you know, for something a bit better, because, you know, we were written off at the age of 11 as you're going to go to secondary modern, you're not going to go to the grammar school, and you that's it, that's you done for life. So if you had an inquiring mind, if you wanted a bit more, you weren't going to get it. That was what you were told you were going to do. So we started reading people like Charles Shaw, Murray, Nick Kent, and that I mean, going from, you know, being told what you're reading, what you're being taught to read in school, to reading people like them, it was quite, once again, mind expanding, and you know, your vocabulary increased exponentially, and you just learned. You were sort of like autodidact, you know, you just taught teaching yourself. And so anyway, this thing, the Guitar Book, came out, and you had to collect it in parts. It was in the centre pages of the NME, and there was a free gift of a card cover to put it in. But it was dead good. It showed you basic chords. It give you a little tune to play, which you recognise. And I had this old Zenta as well. And £5 from Woolies. I was like, it would have come from Woolies, and I bought it off someone for £5, you know. And I got a tune out of that. That's good. I can do that. So anyway, start work. A bit more money. Better guitars. And we used to not lie around with a chap in Fencelles, a young boy, as we were, called Bill Forth. Now, Bill. The reason I mentioned Bill is because he showed us the bar chord. He's like, once he showed us the bar chord, that was it.
Yeah.
Like, no holds barred then. But the sad thing was, in later years, Bill, who we sort of drifted apart from when we were 18, 19, he joined the police force. And in 1992, I think it was, he was murdered at Gateshead. He was a nice lad. Anyway, so we've got the bar chord. We need a drummer. So Peter's younger brother, he knew this lad. He says, he says, Kevin Wilson in our class. He's, because obviously we'd left school, he was younger. He's just bought a set of drums, or his mum and dad have bought a set of drums. Right, tell him he's got to come and play with us. So I think Peter had gone to his house and sort of kept him in his room till he had agreed to go and play the drums. You're not getting out of that room till you agree to play drums. So we all got together after school for Kevin. We went down to it was a couple of Nissen huts, you know, those half round corrugated metal huts.
Yeah.
There was two of those in Fenshouses which belonged to the St John's Ambulance. They did all the training there, and they let us use them on a night, you know. So we started practicing, we started playing really, really ridiculous songs, you know, as you do, like Smoke on the Water and stuff like that. And it sounded awful. It sounded horrible. And this went on for a little bit, but we were getting better. We just thought, well, you know, I suppose that was the definition of a punk band, actually. Because if you go pre-Pistols punk, the definition of a punk band, as defined by the Enemy Book of Rock, I seem to remember, was kids in garages knocking out Louie on cheap instruments and having a serious limitation of ability, which describes us perfectly. Peter came in one day, he says, have you seen this in the Enemy about this group, the Sex Pistols? And I was like, they don't be like some London band, they're always going on about, you know, like the Feel Goods, or, well, I've seen that the Feel Goods were probably doing well by then. Kilburn and the High Roads. They'd be always writing about bands like you'd never heard of.
So you thought these were just.
Same. And he says, well, I'm going to get the single because the witness, he brought in Anarchy in the UK. Wow. You know, I just blew you away, didn't it? You know, it was just amazing. So that was it. I think, I can't remember if it was that he bought first or if it was New Rose. It might have been New Rose.
Because that was the first one.
That was the first one because Peter was always pretty down. He was always like, keeping up with things
on the ball.
So I listened to it and I says, wait, Peter, we could do that. You know, we could write songs. If they can do it, we can do it. And I think he must have bought, because he always had more money than me, he had a better job. And I think he bought the original Spiral Scratch, which I went and bought after I'd heard it the same week. And that thing about doing it yourself became embedded. You know, I said, right, okay, we don't have to play very bad versions of rock music. We can play our own music and we can sing about the things that affect us. So I was like, well, I'll write some songs, you know. Never written a song in my life. And the first one I wrote was absolutely appalling. Some might say the rest were put there. So I had a go and we got together and we realised that because we were setting the rules, nobody could tell us it was wrong. So we'd do that, and then we'd have a go at Suffragette City because we still thought that was cool. You know, that's, and hang on to yourself, they're cool, they're fine. Not the way we played them, like. And
was all this just in rehearsal?
It's just rehearsal. Right. And this is like probably, it's going to be early 77, isn't it? Late 76, 77.
Yeah, well, them singles came out, I think, the autumn of 76.
76. Yeah, so by about January 77, we were like, oh, we were a band. Right. You start calling yourself a band then. And the first name we give ourselves was The Valves. And
did you not know the band existed?
No. We call ourselves The Valves. And remember, we stuck a cassette recorder in our rehearsal room, recorded a tape as perfectly as we could. And we took it to... There was a fella who used to write for the South Shields Gazette, and we'd met him actually. We were at a gig, and he was, because we must have been starting to go to punk gigs then, from 76 onwards, or late 76 onwards. In fact, the first one I went to was The Clash at the Canteen. Oh, was it Subway Set we're playing?
It was.
And The Slits. Mm. So it's like from that period on.
Right.
But when was that, 77?
77, definitely.
I thought, well, we can do this, you know.
What did you think about the fashion side of it?
Well, interestingly enough, obviously, if you go back to 76, 77, and you look at what your average Joe's wearing, it's going to be long hair, you know, but David Cassidy going on the top, you know. Yeah. Flares, probably platforms, huge lapels. And basically what we did was, I think we want to get into this, we just raided our dad's wardrobes and just wore these old jackets from the 60s, you know, with the narrow lapels, some tight button jeans, which I actually got abused for from a passing car. I can't believe that now. short hair, which you definitely got abused for, and flat shoes. And you were, by doing that, you were an outsider. Although now you look very normal.
Mm-hmm.
You were so anti-fashion that you were being abused, but you certainly did not have mohican.
No.
Certainly did not have bondage strides, tartan trousers, safety pins, you know, all that stuff. It was just more about attitude. It was more like saying, look, I'm not, we used to call them trendies. Do you know if you remember that expression? Trendies.
Yeah, definitely.
Mm-hmm. I'm not going to be a trendy. I'm just going to be myself. And if you don't like it, bump it.
Like you say, it was really difficult, especially coming from the north, which was far behind the south, certainly London. That was another planet, wasn't it?
So
people's attitudes around here.
77 we went down, actually. Peter had an old Vauxhall Viva, and it was old then, you know. But we all piled into it, and we went camping, like stopping so far, you know, going down, and we went to see X-ray Specs at, what was the club in Soho? Wasn't the Roxy, it was the other one that did an album of.
The Vortex,
which I found out that night you could make a fortune at a punk gig. After everybody had stopped pogoing, because the floor was just covered in change. I must have came out with more money than I went in with. But I digress. We went to see X-ray Specs, and as you say, it was like being on another planet. It was nothing like up here, you know?
Was it intimidating at all?
Well, even being in London to a fence houses, boy, you've never been out of the village. Was intimidating.
The big city,
as I mean, I say that to my young kids now. I says, you know, we'll go down to London now, and it's just like going to Newcastle.
Mm-hmm.
But in those days, it was literally a foreign land.
But going into this club full of what would have been very dressed up.
Yeah.
Because the pose was...
I mean, you felt a kinship because you liked the music, but you also felt a bit, a lot of people are just posing, you know. And they'll probably move on to the next thing, which Noah probably didn't realise. That's with hindsight.
At the time, it would have been like, At the time, surely the adrenaline would have.
Yeah.
You thought this was the beginning of something.
It was exciting. Yeah. It was.
And you were part of it.
It's like the Clash gig at the one I was talking about at the canteen. That, going in there, it felt scary.
Mm.
It felt like something was going to happen. It felt like. Felt like the police will be here any minute. It felt like we're doing something wrong. It was really good. It was exciting in a good and frightening in a good way. Everything was so staid, and Terry and June, and aberish, and
you so know. Can you understand like the council's worry?
Oh yeah, I mean. A little later on, after we'd been playing for a bit, we used to go and see Harry Hatton and the Big G, because we quite liked them, you know. I used to love Harry Hatton and the Big G. And we went to see them at a pub. Was it Chillingham? Might have been the Chillingham.
Chillingham Arms, isn't it?
It might have been. I could be wrong, don't. And they'd set up the gear, and we were all ready to go, and we were like, yeah. And the manager came out in a suit, and he went ballistic. Get out of my pub, get out, I'm having none of you dirty punks in here, get out, I'm calling the police. And he did call the police. And Peter had his ubiquitous Viva with him, and because it was an estate version, so he got the estate, so we put our gear in the back, and we put the Big J's gear in, we helped them, we took it over to like North Tyneside College or something, and they just played in their canteen over there, there was hardly anybody there, like, because it wasn't expected. But that kind of attitude...
It's really hard to...
It is, you know, these are people who'd served in the water, fought against people like you, you know. They just didn't get it at all.
Yeah.
But, the sense of danger, it's a sense of danger, that's what it was. So you're doing something dangerous, and going to London, that was another sense of danger. And all that sense of danger seems to be gone now. I mean, it really rattles my cage I don't offend anybody here, but like music production and... being in a band is now like the subject of academic courses. That is so against everything I believe in. To me, you play guitar to get on people's nerves.
Yeah.
You don't do it to get a degree, you know?
No, I'm with you.
Mm-hmm. It's just, and it's just what they've done is they've basically neutered it.
Yeah. Excellent.
Coming away from the Vortex, back home, I think Althea and Donna were on top of the props. Because it was like ice cold and Alex, we went straight back to the station, fence houses, and down 3 pints of lager. And Althea and Donna were on top of the props. And even that was a little bit different, you know what I mean?
It still reminds you of 1977, song mind.
Yeah, and I thought, there's something changing, there's something happening, there's a buzz. You know, there's definitely a vibe, a buzz. So we persevered. We tried to get a gig. Now, interesting thing was, Gary Chapman was on here talking about their first gig. Well, their gig at, I think it was Jubilee Day down at the Guildhall.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, I was there.
Were you?
Yeah. And because I always remember, we started off at the bridge, as you do, and went down the quayside and we went into the Red House, I think
it is. Yeah, right, on the corner.
On the corner, and somebody put a record on and I went, hey, that sounds exactly like the Pistols. And so we said, no, it's the Jam. You know where it was, don't you, in the city. So that was exciting. That was new. That was another band. Oh, that sounds great. Across the road, now that gig, when Penetration played that night, atmosphere was fantastic. And I remember standing at the front watching this band, and I was about literally 18 inches away from this bloke waving his hands about singing, you know, and I thought, who's this? This is ridiculous. And that bass player, he kind of plays bass, he's just going up and down one string, you know, but that was Hook.
Yeah.
And the singer was
Ian Curtis,
you know, which to this day I find absolutely amazing, you know.
So close.
So close, eh? but that's what you could do then. Mm. I mean, that was Warsaw. I saw them when they started and they were brilliant because they were just a punk band. They were the same as us.
Yeah.
Which I like. Mm. I like that. I like that they weren't, you know, every trendy DJ's choice, you know. And then Penetration came on, Pauline told me to F off, which was, you know, I was like, yeah, I'll part of it. Because I'm stand going, I can't hear you. She just says, off. But, I mean, where else? You wouldn't have had that contact with anyone at the City Hall, you know. It was great. And then you'd see everybody afterwards drinking. So we thought, we've got to get a gig. And I think the first one, and I've got no idea how we got it, was in Gatsby's.
Right. It isn't documented as much as your Newcastle venues. This was in Whitley Bay.
It's in Whitley Bay, yeah, on the corner, on the seafront. Now, the first time we played Gatsby's, I think it was our first gig. I'm pretty sure. No, I could be telling a lie. It might have been our second gig. So I'll backpedal because I need to check with. Cause everything's written down. Peter's got everything written down somewhere. So either the first gig was Gatsby's or it was the Guildhall in the November of 77, and it was the Prestodes, the Proles, it was a Rot Against Racism do. I think we contacted Alan Willey, who ran Rot Against Racism, said, can we play? And he stuck us on the bill. I'm sure Speed were playing, because I've got a fanzine from the time that, because I went on and played bass for Speed, because their bass player couldn't turn up. I don't know what I was playing, mine. I was just like, that sounds like, could be right, you know. And that was maybe Octoberish. Rot Against Racism at the Guildhall, and that was so exciting. That was absolutely fantastic. But Pete, you know, you'd go on, you'd play, you'd be rubbish, and everybody would cheer. You know? Yeah. And it was just like, well, everyone's having a go. Just, we don't care, we're just enjoying ourselves. Yeah. So it might have been the second one at Gatsby's. Kevin couldn't make it because he was working at Caterpillar at the time. We all had jobs. Mm. I mean, this is what... I mean, we weren't the kind of people who were just like, who could afford to give up jobs to go and live in a squat, you know, which would have been cool. But we weren't middle class, you know. We all had that sort of, you're going to work or you starve ethos, if you want to call it that. So Kevin didn't play and we played at Gatsby's and that went down really well. Oh, maybe I'm lying. No, it was the second time Kevin played there. And that went down quite well as well. Although I remember Ian Gibson Anderson, I can't remember his name. He used to sell records in the Snare.
Right.
I know Martin's going to interview him for the book. But I always remember seeing it because I had a Gibson bass by this time, which I was still paying for, you know, every week, every month, because I was working the electricity board. The guy in his name, I'm sure, he was tall and thin. He was called Pete somebody.
Mm.
Not Pete Mayburn, was it? Oh, I can't remember. Anyhow, so that was Rot Against Racism, that gig we did. I've still got the poster somewhere. That was a great night.
Did that go off without any kind of mayhem, which did follow the Rot Against Racism?
I always seem to remember the police coming in after every gig. Because I remember later on, Rock Against Racism, which was basically the Proles and Alan Witherley in Newcastle, put on, well, Alan was doing all the organisation, he was the solicitor, so he had all the contacts, and we couldn't have done anything like that. We got Stiff Little Fingers to play, and we were the band, we were the bar, rather, not the band. So all the drinks, they brought in piles and piles of slabs of lager, and we were the volunteer bar staff for the night for that gig. And I remember we were going around picking up all the empties, because I thought, well, it's bad for the organisation if we leave the hall in the state it's in, and the police were in the hall with Alsatians, you know. And I was thinking, oh my God, I'm going to get eaten here. But there was, every time there was a punk gig in Newcastle, that was always police out.
Yeah.
It's always.
So it wasn't like being infiltrated by other factions such as skinheads or anything, it was the police that
way. I can't remember there being a great deal of bother, because there were, by the end of the gig, there was at the police row was there, you know. But I think, as we've talked earlier about the Mekons gig, and I think there was bother at that one.
There was.
Yeah. Because we were, I don't know what we did for that one. Did we do the bar again? Or we did something, because we were always like there in a volunteer capacity, you know. We'd rather have been playing on the stage, but we thought, well, you know,
just involved in the scene.
Just involved. You're talking about a scene where it's debatable whether there was a scene.
That is the big question. Uh-huh. I ask everybody.
I mean, to me, there was a bunch of people who all got to know each other through. So the Proles would know Speed just on passing acquaintance sort of. And there was a girl who saw herself as a journalist for like a fanzine. She loved Speed, and Deborah, they called her, that's right. And they'd come to our gigs, we'd go to their gigs, and it would be like emergency exit and the press studs. We all sort of, and then of course there was the Condemned who we'd seen supporting somebody, and we loved them. We loved the Condemned, mainly for the fact that they were like, you know, they were
kids.
They were kids and they were like playing this pub on a night. Yeah. And we just thought, oh, they can support us anytime. And we struck up a great rapport with the Condemned, loved them people, marvellous. And when we came to finance the single, the Rock Against Racers and Me P, we asked them if they had a tape, did they want to put it on? So that's how they ended up with, because it was like the Proles and the Condemned, they're a package, you know?
Yeah. We'll be right back.
But that was out of sheer goodwill, you know, that kind of goodwill between bands that that existed. There was also competition between bands.
Right.
We'd hear ourselves being slagged off quite a lot, you know, and fair enough. That's you set yourself up, you set yourself to be knocked down. Mm. But it was from people in other bands who were always trying to promote their band.
Mm.
But it didn't matter at the end of the day because the angelic upstarts won. through sheer, you know, force of presence.
All right.
And,
are we talking 1978 here?
We're talking 78. We're in full flight.
Like Gatsby's and that. Are we going right back?
Gatsby's would have been 77.
So in 77, if we're going to like concentrate on that. Were you doing many gigs in 77?
Not so many.
Venues were possibly hard to come.
I think we asked if we could support somebody at the Bridge, maybe. We probably did Gatsby's, the Guildhall. I should have brought the list because we still got the list.
Right.
It wasn't until 78 we got into our stride and started doing a lot of pubs in Newcastle, which was fair enough. And at one point, we would play maybe two or three a week,
right.
But it was all in Newcastle, and you sort of wear your welcome out, you know what I mean? Mm.
What was the presence like, as in crowd? Was there a regular
good at the start.
Audience?
Good at the start, and we played Newcastle Trades Council. It was some kind of union thing, and we'd played a gig for them for free down Newcastle Trades Council. They had a premises down on the quayside, down near the Guildhall. It's probably a sushi restaurant now, you know. But,
apartments or something.
That had gone really well, and they'd asked us if we would play an open air gig to raise funds for it on the town moor.
Mm.
So we said yes. We got there on the Saturday morning. And there was no stage. I said, well, where we're playing? Oh, we've got a stage, but it's at the Newcastle University Theatre. They're going to loan it to us. All right, so they borrowed our van, because we knew a lad with a van, you know, as you do, all clapped out thing. So we hauled the stage up to the, and it went on and on and on. And they said, you're going to have to go on, you're not getting a sound check. By this time, we were getting really irritated, you know, because we'd been there before they got there. We'd waited for them. They hadn't organised the stage. They hadn't done this. So we went on. We did a song. And I said something like, we'd like to thank the organisers that couldn't organise it up in a brewery. And no, they just went ballistic. Off! Get off! Get off! So sort of petulantly chucked over a microphone stand, jumped off the stage, picked up my bass amp with both hands, just hurled it onto the ground, and we just went. And we had a gig at the Bridge the following night, and it was full. There was people sitting on the windowsills. There was,
right.
You know, and I just thought, is that what you've got to do? Have you got to, you know? Didn't matter about your music. Have you got to have that sort of, there's going to be trouble kicking off if we play, which I think is a bit sad.
Mm-hmm.
But
well, maybe it's people are just excited by
you. I was excited, yeah.
There's somebody that's prepared to see what he means.
Because I completely lost it.
Yeah.
And that was probably the best night we had at the Bridge. And I think the following day after that was when we went into Spectral and recorded our first four songs for a demo.
Right. What year was this?
Oh, in 78, I think.
This is 78.
Yeah, and the early 78. And that was, those songs were absolutely terrible. I mean, they were recorded on two track, bounced about four times, you know, and they just sound horrible.
We'll be right back.
the end of 78, there came the opportunity, I think it was Alan Witherley, and we wanted to do something ourselves. And Alan had a bit of cash that they'd raised from Rock Against Racism. And we talked about doing an EP, you know, and this is where Inviting the Condemned came in, because they'd played that many gigs for Rock Against Racism with us. We played a lot of Rock Against Racism stuff. So we did that. And we recorded Stereo Love and Thoughtcrime, like Pick Your Best Songs, you know, at Impulse, Wall's End. Mm. I remember because I had to carry my HH bass combo up a flight of stairs, you know, up about seven flights of stairs to the projectionist room in the old cinema. And I mean, the lads who recorded us, they're probably more used to recording heavy metal acts, but I think they did quite well.
They got it
exactly, and they made some suggestions like multi-tracking the four-track Stereo Love bit. Like, go and sing that again, right? Go and sing that again. And I thought, well, what we're doing, you know? But and they produced it. I don't know who they are to this day, but whatever they did, they just caught like a little bit of magic, you know? And it seems to be still quite popular, which I'm pleased about.
It is. It's deemed as a classic single.
Really?
It really is.
Well, somebody put it on YouTube, not me. It's on now because I've put the live version on from when we played in Blackpool in the 90s. And it's like, I mean, it's not tons of views. It's like 4,000 or 5,000 or something, which is nothing in the YouTube terms. But I've had some comments on it from people in Texas, and you know, and it's quite nice to
think
from fence houses to Texas. Mm-hmm. You know? So, and that to me is enough achievement. We set out to be, you know, rich and famous, like everybody did with the guitar. Don't deny it. You set out to be rich and famous, and just doing that is it's satisfying.
The whole punk thing waned, and you were filling that void with still that punk attitude, but the Proles were always, it was a pop punk kind of sound coming out, you know. It wasn't what punk became later, where everybody wanted to be as noisy as possible, to shout as much. This still retained a musical element, although it was still punk rock, you know.
You know, you talk about influences, and I mean, I wanted to be in Spiders from Mars. That was like, you know, if I could have been the spider. But and so you've got that sort of boy T-Rex-ish, I only say Roxy Music, but I never liked Roxy Music, actually. Everybody quotes them as being like their arty band, and I just think we're a bunch of posers. I like pop music. You know, I don't like cheesy pop music, but I like the 3-minute single that gives you the kick in the pants, and you think, oh, that was awesome. And I found the Buzzcocks were marvellous at that. I think Pete Shelley to this day is one of the best songwriters that, you know, punk ever threw up. In fact, we got accused of sounding like them.
I was just going to say, if I was going to like sort of throw like an influence, I would have said Buzzcocks without a doubt. But I wouldn't have said you were plagiarising them or anything like that.
No, it's like ploughing the same furrow.
Yeah.
Because I, as a teenager, I always had a sort of romantic streak, you know? So it was like, I was doing the sort of, it's kind of embarrassing now, I suppose, but it was the sort of like, the unrequited love punk, do you know what I mean? I did get political in some songs, because
Thoughtcrime, obviously.
Thoughtcrime, and I do feel, I hate the way people are manipulated and controlled. But I think there was also room for that type of, you know, love song, you know, which they weren't really, because they were always about being ignored. It's like the reality of being like a 17-year-old or 19-year-old lad, and, you know, all the good-looking girls are taken by all the football stars, and, you know. I think John Hughes made an entire career out of it, making films about it, you know. It's the same sort of thing, isn't it?
Yeah.
But I was putting it in the context of living in a pit village. I think. I hope I was.
Why do you have to be so apologetic? Why do you have to be so nice? You've never been like this before. You're making me think twice. I'm thinking twice about you and me, things we could have done. Now I can see that our second feature should have been second to none. 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 Yeah.
So, like, following the Rock Against Racism single, how did the single with Small Wonder come about?
That was literally a case of chucking demos at record companies. We got one of those famous stiff replies, you know, where it says, I think the Undertones got the same one. Have you ever seen it?
No.
Or if anyone wants to see it, go on to the Proles Facebook page, and it's under Peter's album, and it's a letter from Stiff, and I'm not going to repeat it, you just have to read it, it's so right. funny. And they sent it out to thousands of bands.
Yeah,
you know, you have officially been rejected type of letter, and it's really funny, but it was worth keeping. Pete Stennett from Small Wonder got back in touch, which was, I thought, was really strange, because as I say, the Carpets from Hortonley Spring, which is just, I mean, Fence Houses was actually part of Hortonley Spring.
Mm-hmm.
In, you know, council terms, he'd signed the Carpets, and then he'd give us the chance. He liked SMK, the instrumental, and he wanted to do that. And I thought like we need something poppy, and I thought Softground was like written to be poppy. It was written to be like an A-side, so we got the chance to record those at Pity Me in Durham.
Yeah, with Terry.
Terry Cavigan.
What do you think? I mean, you spoke to Gary again. Terry was one for leaving you for a few hours at a time.
Oh, he was gallons of coffee, I remember.
Plenty of stories.
He was pretty much on the ball that day.
Right.
Uh-huh. Tell you what he did do, though. We recorded four songs. One's called 73, which is on our CD, which is very much about living in 1973 and going to school and being the odd one out, you know.
Right.
And there was a drum break in it, diddle-dun, diddle-dun, and he must have made Kevin play it about 150 times since he got it right. And Kevin was like, I'm going to kill him, I'm going to kill him. But, I think the results sound... I would have liked a bit more power behind it. You know, it sounds very light, very frothy, the way it's recorded. Yeah. And when we did it live, it had a lot more guts, you know. But...
I don't know what it did in sales, but it's still a very popular song.
There was 5,000 pressed, and Small Wonder claimed that they never sold enough to get back, you know.
Hmm.
But trying to get a hold of one, they said they sent a load back to be turned into plant pots or something, you know.
Seriously.
But that came about because Cherry Red bought the catalogue of Small Wonder, and Cherry Red more or less said, well, we don't owe you anything and we own your song.
Right.
Because it's something to do with cross-collateralization. But the fact that we were like 19-year-old or something, signed a contract without a solicitor, I'm sure if we'd pursued it,
yeah,
you know, would we've more or less lost that song legally.
Right.
The recording.
Because I think it's Softground that's on a Small Wonder compilation.
It is,
CD. Mm-hmm. So you've got nothing off of that.
Get nothing, but by the same chalk, we allowed two other CD, two record companies, to put it on. We gave them like the master we had. In fact, I'm not sure how they did it, because we didn't. We must have had a duplicate, because the master went to Small Wonder and they kept it. You know, like we paid for that. It's ours, which they did. So
the Proles playing live, was it northeast only? Did you go further?
I think we went as far as Leeds.
Right.
We went to Leeds probably one. It was my birthday actually, January the 26th. It was snowing. It was absolutely freezing. Back of a transit van, sitting on a drum all the way to Leeds. Got there. It was quite a good gig. It was like the equivalent of their canteen, you know. And it was with a band called the Abrasive Wheels.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I quite enjoyed that. It was good.
What year would this have been then?
I would have been 78 or 79.
Right.
I mean, gosh, you get...
Because the Abrasive Wheels became part of that next generation of punks.
Yeah. We started to notice this, that there was another... And it was a different generation. I know we were talking about it earlier. It's... It was hard. I tell you, the first inkling I had of it was when we went to Walthamstow to sign the contract with Small Wonder. I had to talk to them. We had a weekend away, and Pete Stennett had. He says, "Oh, yeah." He was like his happy buddy, you know. And he said, "Oh, this is he's a hippie, really."
Right.
He says, "And this is the band you want. We signed this band, the Great Crass."
Right.
And that was the first inkling I'd had of like that second wave or third wave, really, of really hardcore punk, which wasn't melodic, which wasn't poppy, which was quite in your face and aggressive, and wasn't what we were doing at all, really. Wasn't arty. Wasn't like, Gary Chapman's talking about art school rock, you know.
Yeah.
And this,
yeah.
I quite agree with what he said about the Northeast. Like, this was our art school rock. This is a, you know. We used to go to the uni to see bands, and we used to be so jealous of the students, because we had to go for work the next day, and we wanted their life, and we couldn't do it, you know. And they were the one. They were the ones who were forming bands. I could be wrong. I could be entirely wrong. But I think like Punishment of Luxury, they came across as being very arty, studenty types.
Yeah.
You know.
I mean, I'm not sure if they were students or such, but it was. It was art, it was theatre, wasn't
it? Theater.
I think they came from a theatre group.
Theatre group, right.
I think so, I could be wrong, but...
But, I mean, they weren't the same social class as us. Do you understand what I'm saying? They were...
Did you feel that at the time?
Oh,
did
yeah.
Did they come across like that, did they?
Yeah.
Right.
I knew when the guitarist said about all his gear, he was insured, and I thought, what's insurance?
Oh, nice.
You know, I mean, we were literally...
Yeah,
rednecks, you know, sort of.
But I thought you would have felt everybody was in the same predicament, and it wasn't the case.
No, it wasn't that at all.
You'd all sort of been involved in this.
Anyone who says it was, you know, was a great scene, and it was, you know, there were occasions when you'd go to listen here on a Saturday afternoon, and it'd bump into Brian Gibson, the photographer who did all the bands, and you'd have a chat with him. He was a lovely lad, and there was a few others. It was Kevin Anderson who worked there, that's right. He didn't like the Proles much either. But it was very cliquey.
I've heard that so many times.
Very
as well.
Cliquey. It was very cliquey, very, very centred around, a lot of it around speed. I mean, the majority of them were nice lads, I've got to say that.
But I would have said speed would have lasted but a year. Surely there was no speed in 78.
I think it changed singer.
Oh, right.
Johnny Fusion, he called himself Royal. He went to form a band called Battery D.
Right.
And I think we saw them a couple of times.
Was that still in the punk vein then?
I think it was a bit more arty.
Right.
I think it was a bit more arty. I think you're starting to see the odd synthesizer coming. I'm not sure if they had one, but you're getting bands where they were starting to do that, you know, like Magazine would, you know.
Did you have any affinity with that then?
I like Magazine. I liked
that. Did you not feel sort of threatened by the keyboard coming in as a guitar bass band?
I kind of hated it, really.
Did you? Some punks kind of went one way or the other. They went harder or they went softer with this electronic sound.
I never took to even the Hammond organ in the Stranglers. I never really took to that. You know, even though it was really fantastic when he played it, and it was something like you'd never heard before. The arpeggio was going up and down, you know.
You didn't feel it belonged.
I didn't feel it. I suppose I had a very blinking, narrowed view. And my view was, I'm this poor kid from a pit village who kind of get a girlfriend. That's what it's about for me. Who's got life chances are severely limited by the fact that, you know, if you didn't have an apprenticeship or whatever, you were a ghost.
Right.
Your life was like planned out for you.
Yeah, yeah.
You know.
Boys in a class, 73.
time and entertaining friends and no flat of mine. No one stares. We all watch. We all wait for terminal breaks. We can't see that if we try to turn them off and choose it. They were crying, screaming, dying.
Still feeling that at this time?
Oh yeah, I mean right up until the very end. I mean I remember having a great sense of disappointment when I realised, you know, this is the finish, we're not going to do it. Yeah, and that was brought about by Scar. It was interesting, I said we went down to London to Waltham store to sign for Small Wonder. And when we were down there, Quadrophenia had just come out, and we thought we'd kill some time. We went to the Warners in Leicester Square to see Quadrophenia, amazed at the prices at the time. And it was all mod, pork pie hats.
Yeah.
And I'll bet, you know, when was that? I bet that was 79. I'll bet within 3 months, the most punkiest of punk in Newcastle was wearing a pork pie hat,
you're right.
A narrow tie and a suit, because there was this one kid, he was always at gigs, and you used to see him on the tube. I don't know how he always managed to get himself on the tube. You used to see him in audiences, and then you'd see him, and he was real, you know, oh, he's a punk, definitely.
Yeah.
And we saw him, and he was a mod, and we just thought, this is it, it's finished.
Yeah, I knew quite a few like that.
This is the end, and it was. The next thing we knew, it was the enemy was raving about Scar, and Two Tone and Selector and all the rest of it, and I felt then like yesterday's news.
Yeah.
You thought something that was gonna like just keep trundling along, and you know, I mean, I know now with hindsight that most things last 3 years,
yeah,
tops if you're lucky.
I mean, this music to me, I look back, I think I felt even at the time that this was a retro thing. So I never belonged to it because I was looking to the future.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah,
punk to me was the future. And what came after punk, like the post-punk thing, it remained the future for so many years. And then we started looking back. I do remember mid-80s. And as soon as we started looking back, I kind of relaxed me interest,
yeah,
if you can say, you know.
Got to a point somewhere about 84 and I'd really lost complete interest in music.
I don't understand.
Mm-hmm. Because what we did was considered so passé, you know, and what was around was so shallow, glossy, shiny, and Yamaha DX7.
Yeah,
you
it
know,
was corporate, wasn't it?
It was so corporate. Then. You had Pepsi sponsoring Tina Turner, and worst of all, you had Pepsi sponsoring David Bowie. And David Bowie turned into a huge disappointment, you know.
It's funny you say that, because not many people look back on that. They look back on David Bowie and it's still with this sort of rose tinted glasses that,
well, you see,
he was the be all and end all.
I have followed his career and I have just about bought, well, I have bought every album he's brought out up until the last one. So I suppose it's like I'm always hoping the next one's going to be good, you know? And I mean, in the 80s, there were some stinkers and he knew there was. I mean, that's why he tried to change everything with the tin machine. But everyone, I don't know, it's like he's regarded now, but there again you get 19-year-old girls wearing Ramones t-shirts who don't know what the Ramones are.
Yeah.
You know, and or Rolling Stones tongue, or it's just become, the 70s was so cool, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, it was, but you've got to do something yourself.
Mm.
It's just become off the peg. Fashion icons.
Definitely. It is a really sort of sterile time.
It's a very sterile time. It has been for a long time.
Yeah, I know. I don't think there's any way back neither.
No. Yeah. Because there's no sense now that there's anyone to fight against. Because everyone's wanting to be a success. And everyone sees success as something that you can get by, well, you can, I suppose, you know, by hard work, academic career, but also there's that sense of, I could be a success by keeping in with my superiors. There's a heck of a lot of crawling, you know.
Totally agree.
Crawling to.
We're going to come up with some names, or not, like mm-hmm. some terms.
Sycophancy. Yeah. Yeah, there's a heck of a lot of sycophancy in society now.
There's not a lot of honesty.
No, there's no one, exactly, there's no one will stand up and say, hang on, this is wrong, this is right.
For fear.
Because they're frightened.
That's interesting you're saying that, because we're going right back to you being young and realising that then. You know, people being fake.
Yeah.
And we went through a phase of saying, I'm not going to put up with that. I'm going to change things. And amazingly enough, nearly 40 years later, we're exactly where we were.
But
it seems that
but in a far more sinister way, I think.
Right.
Because I think that then people honestly believed, I know it was control, but people believed in society. They believed in the goodness of society. You know, the NHS was strong, and you know, the socialists had changed society for the better. Now you've got this society which is like this neoliberal society,
yeah,
and it's all about looking after number one and standing on other people, and that's become acceptable, whereas in the past that was not acceptable.
Produce products for industry. A mass-produced person is all you are. Till the day you die, you won't go far. Hard to take, hard to bear. Life's no fun when you're going nowhere. Hard to take, hard to bear. Life's no fun when you're going nowhere. Put you out to grass. Can't do nothing now but sit in your ass. Life's a joke, that's what I said. But 6 months later you're stepping, you're dead. Hard to take, hard to bear. Life's no fun when you're going nowhere. Hard to take, hard to bear. Life's no fun when you're going nowhere. Hard to take, hard to bear. Life's no fun when you're going nowhere. Hard to take, hard to bear. Life's no fun when you're going nowhere.
So with all this in mind, what do you think about people who still hang on to punk as a, what I said before, they sometimes claim it's a way of life. Can it be a way of life? Because are they changing things still?
No, it's not a way of life. It can't be. It was a glorious summer in 1977, 78, whichever was your summer. And I tell you what, I used to, when I started work, I used to work with a lot of people, a lot of men, who'd served in the war. I mean, they were the age, when I was 18, they were the age I am now in the 50s. And they used to talk about, old Arthur, used to talk about being sunk by the Japanese, torpedoed, all the rest of it. They'd be on about firing the pom-poms at the Japs and all this. And they loved it. And the reason they loved it was because it was their youth.
Yeah.
And you say, Arthur, what are you talking about? You're talking about a war. There's nothing glorious about war. He says, great, man. You know? But that was because... I mean, your other fellas who were a bit more sensible would say, oh, John, it was horrible. You know?
Yeah.
But it's that same attitude, isn't it? It's that time of your life when there's no other time to be... I think you get you do get one chance to be young. And... it is the best time of your life, and everything after that is just surviving.
So what would you say to a 50-year-old or a 50-plus-year-old punk who still believes in the dress code? And
I don't think they would listen. I don't think there'd be any point saying anything because they have made their mind up. It's like, I suppose they're like old Teds, aren't they, basically. I would like nothing better to get up on stage, sing and play, because that's what I love to do. But I look in the mirror in the morning and I think, I wouldn't go and see you, you know. I want to see somebody fresh, energetic, young, doing the business.
Is there any possibilities of making the music and not worrying about doing it live?
I have thought about
it. Satisfaction out of just making the music.
I still play the guitar and I still try and write songs, and I record them at home because it's so easy to do now on your PC, you know, and you can get a fantastic drum sound, which you couldn't get with a real drum kit. So I do that, you know, and I think sometimes, oh, if I had an audience, I'd finish this song, because I've come up with some cracking ideas for songs, because I always remember Kevin saying to me, he says, I'll say one thing for you, John, you can come up with a catchy song, you know, and I still can, I'm happy to see it. But I just feel like, who's going to want to listen to it, you know, so I never finish them.
You might be surprised. Seriously. You might be surprised.
Yeah.
if we go back again to get everything into perspective, the end of the Proles, was that listen, lads, this is it?
It got to the point where we were playing the Trent House, the Bridge, Dog and Parrot, and literally the people in the audience were the people we took with us. And you got the feeling that it was ebbing away, the whole thing of going to the town and seeing people you knew who were in bands, people writing fanzines or whatever. It was just, you saw no one, and it became a pointless exercise. And by the time the NME had written off the new wave, and then you had this next generation. I remember we played in Newcastle one night, actually, I think it was the Dog and Parrot, and UK Subs were on at the Mayfair.
Right.
And I said to somebody, well, I think we popped in after the gig to see them. And the thing that struck me was there was like a generational difference, not a generation, because he only taught in 5 years, maybe. There were a younger generation watching, and they were passive. Now, I remember when we were going to see the Ramones, the Buzzcocks, Ziggy and Stranglers and 999 and... not Emergency Exit, that was a local one, wasn't it? That wave.
Yeah.
You'd go in and the place would be leaping.
Yeah.
And everyone in this younger generation, this younger audience, was stood there static in front of UK Subs. And I thought, that's interesting. There wasn't that energy, there wasn't that
that
danger, there wasn't, it was just a gig. They were all fans, don't get us wrong, they were all like, yay! But there wasn't that. I'm not having to go to anybody here because I am from a council estate. I am an ordinary working class lad from a council estate originally. But I found that the first wave, the people who were going were students, they were intellectuals, they were, you know, and we were the minority. And then I found with that second wave, there were just more people like me.
Yeah.
You know, and the arty crowd had said, that's finished. We want nothing to do with it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I agree. I think that's why that next generation as such possibly still passionate about it. I think the people in the 50s and that are hanging on to the punk are possibly from that generation.
They tend to be less the first wave, I mean, because the first wave, it wasn't just about punk. I mean, it was punk, but it was reggae. It was Patti Smith.
Yeah.
You know, it wasn't just your Mohican, your Bondage Strides, and your shouting at the audience. Yeah.
It wasn't punk by numbers, was it? It was just sort of diverged, didn't it?
Uh-huh.
Lots of different directions, but it met at some point.
Like the Slits, if you listen to the Slits, I mean...
They're like nobody.
You can't define them. But they were classed as a new wave.
Yeah.
I think that's what happened. It went from being new wave to punk, and then it got diluted by people like Elvis Costello, who your first take on people like that was, well, they're punk as well. They're new wave, and then pretty soon you realise, well, actually, they're not. They're in that singer songwriter category that that's going to appeal to, the literary crowd.
So we spoke about the end of the Proles, but you did reform, was it in the 90s?
Yeah.
How did that come about?
We all had very young families then, and we hadn't had time to do anything, and we were just getting on with work and having ordinary lives, and we were probably getting a bit bored. And I don't know how it happened, but there was myself and the two Kevins started going to Newcastle. There's a rehearsal room in Newcastle. It's like out towards where Parsons was, where Jack Ford Motors used to be in that roundabout. I can't remember the name, but anyway. So I say rehearse. It wasn't rehearsing. It was plugging our guitars in, taking the drums. Of course, Kevin didn't have to take his drums. There was drums already there. He just had to take his sticks. So it was dead good. Going Saturday morning and just let off sting. And then Pete started coming down as well. And Kevin had said he was doing the washing up in the kitchen with his missus. And he had Radio 1 on. and one of our tracks was playing on Radio 1 on Steve Lamacq, and it was one of those, what they call a bed, where they talk over it. It was an instrumental track we'd done. So Kevin was like dead excited, and I think he got in touch with PRS, and we managed to get some money. You know, it's like Kevin never thinking about money. If you got a few quid, it would have been worth it, you know. So what we did was, which I'm quite proud of, I thought it was quite constructive, we said, right, what we'll do is we've got that money, what we'll do is we'll go and record some of the songs that we never got the chance to record properly as the Proles, like 15 years ago or 20 years ago, we'll go and do them again. So we went to Fred Purse's studio, and he is absolutely wonderful, that man. I love Fred, marvellous. And he recorded four songs from the past that we hadn't done, and they were quite canny. So we stuck them together and we sent them, and there's a chap in the local area called John Esplin, who runs he had a record company. What was it called? Wasn't One Louder, was it? Can't remember. Anyway, he put a CD out of the Proles, so that one was called Stereo Love. And then...
That wouldn't have been Overground
Records. Overground Records. Yeah,
that's the only one I could think of.
Ah, it's Overground Records. So he put that out, and we'd gather together all the demos going back years, and the new tracks were done. And then I think we did a few more in somebody's loft at Birtley, which didn't sound that brilliant, but they were all right. And we got an offer from Kevin, because Kevin was—he's a funny lad. He got in touch with Jello Biafra. You know, you do, don't you? You know. And Jello Biafra had written back and said, "Oh, this is who you need to see." And it was this guy in America who runs Grand Theft Audio Records, and he'd loved it. He loved what he heard, and he put out a CD over there. So it was quite great. You know, the Proles, Glendale, California, on the bottom. You know, it's a long way from Fence Hills. Because he'd said that, what was he said? Oh, he said, told Kevin that SMK had gone down really well on the Strip. You know, and you're thinking, that's ludicrous. That's, yeah, you know, that's ridiculous. It's some punk club, and he put another one out with some extra tracks on the Overground one's got some live tracks as well, recorded on a cassette recorder, yeah, naturally.
Where are they from? When are they from?
Do you know? I can't remember.
Are they like the 70s or?
I think we got together about 1980 again to do a one-off at Christmas, right after we'd finished, but it was just a one-off literally, you know, just for the local lads. Sort of small, and we never had ambitions above our station. We would have loved someone to come along and say, yes, you're good, we're going to do this with you. But we never went out and grabbed it by the throat, you know.
Did you think, again, I think, speaking to a few people, we've talked about coming from the northeast, and if you want it, you're going to have to go and seek it. They're not going to come to us,
yeah. I mean, that became blatantly obvious when we were sending demos away as well, you know. And I think if you're going to do it, you had to be like Penetration. You had to have the guts to get into a van, go to London and do it there. Mm-hmm. And not, I mean, you know, fair play to them, they did really well. Last time I saw Gary Chaplin, I was sitting, you'll not remember, I was sitting in the balcony of a Chris Benn concert at the Mayfair.
Right.
I mean, I was sitting talking.
That must be a long time ago.
It was a long time ago.
Knocked down for a while.
Yeah. Oh, this was like during the, you know, it was about 79.
Oh, right. So, CD releases here and America.
Yeah.
You did speak about holidays in this song.
Yes, we were invited to play at Blackpool in 94, I believe it was, Holidays in the Sun, which was promoted by Cherry Red. And I mean, it was dead good, because there was people there, like the Buzzcocks, who I've got the utmost admiration for, but the majority of them were this like second wave, I knew you said second division, I meant second wave of punk acts, who were all very shouty and aggressive and a bit self-parody, I think.
So how did you feel that you fitted in?
I felt that we didn't, actually.
Were you conscious of that?
I was very conscious of not being part of it, because it was a bit like, it seemed to be a very closed circle of people who were there. I mean, the people who were there were so committed to it. I mean, you know, people my age with Mohegans, Bright Purple and all the rest of it and all the post-punk gear, you know, like the bondage strides and what have you. And me and Peter looked at each other and said, well, we were there in 77 and it wasn't like this. Mm-hmm. This is like the Daily Mirror version of punk.
Yeah.
This is the tourist version of punk, but these people were totally committed to it and they believed it. We went on, I think, there was another band playing next door who were fairly big, because there was two stages, and I think they got most of the audience. Well, no, they did get most of the audience. But there was a small gaggle of Japanese chaps who loved us, which I thought was marvellous. Yeah. Yeah, big in Japan. Eh? But the crowd that stayed with us thoroughly enjoyed it. I was really nervous. I've actually put a couple of clips up on YouTube if anybody wants to have a look at that. I think we did Stereo Love and another, the clips, Stereo Love and another couple of songs. And if, I mean, we enjoyed it. We got paid for the first time ever, you know. I mean, as in, you are being paid for doing this. Yeah. But there was this sense that the people here, they love it and they're thoroughly committed to it, and all power to them because they're doing something that other people won't do, but they missed the point.
Yeah.
It was like a rock and roll weekend, you know, where the girls wear bobby socks and the lads wear the bright blue coat. What do you call those coats? They wear
Chromy.
Velvet coats. Yeah,
the drapes.
The drapes. They wear the bright, look like shawadi wadi.
Yeah.
Well, if you'd gone back to like Newcastle in 1958, I'm sure they wouldn't have looked like shawadi wadi. You know, they would have been a lot harder. It's all a bit dressy up. A bit sad.
So following that, then the Proles. Was that the end again?
That was the end again, really. Apart from, I mean, I don't see the two Kevins, unfortunately, although I still regard them as friends. I mean, that is the thing I would like to stress about the Proles, that we were friends first.
Mm-hmm.
And we always have been.
Yeah.
I mean, Peter still looks out for me, and I look out for him as much as we can, you know. So that comes before anything. We're not one of these bands that are just, you know, oh, I know somebody who will do this, I know somebody who plays a guitar, and then you never see them again. We've been in each other's pockets all our lives. So it's more like family than anything else. So there's a lot of love there, you know.
Stone Age men with laser beams. We have all these toys and hopelessness. We are judged by our gains and die by our schemes. All our sins betray our weariness. Oh, we can rise above our common curse. If dreams follow, please follow. Disgrace our perfection with cheap infection of jealousy, lies, and hate. Oh, we can rise above our common curse. If dreams follow, please follow. Sleep the sleep of innocence. If dreams follow, please follow. We'll be right back.
can you describe your life sort of with the Proles and what long-term effect it's left you?
Yeah, right. Being in the Proles was absolutely amazing. It was, even though the success was never, you know, what we would have dreamt of, just being in that situation of getting up in the morning and knowing that you and like-minded friends were all working together, but it wasn't work, all wanting to do something together, to make something. And when you got there and you stood on that stage, you had your friends beside you and you were doing the thing that you loved doing best. And then all the ancillary stuff around it was just a bonus. It was just, it was a really, really happy time. I mean, I would, if I'd, you know, if you could go back to a time in your life and relive it, I would go back to that, definitely, because it was the best. It felt as if I was actually in control of my own life for the first time ever. And I don't think I've felt like that since. In fact, I know I haven't felt like that since. And the thing it's left us with is that it's not much, but occasionally you'll get, somebody will stick one of our songs up on YouTube and then somebody from Texas will comment on it, or somebody from Russia or China, and you think, good grief, that was me sitting in my bedroom at my mum's house on the bed writing a song and somebody's, you know, thinks it's fantastic, and they live on the other side of the world, and it just is the most amazing feeling, and that is satisfaction enough, really. I would have liked to have been rich and successful, but when I look at the people who have done that, they've usually had a price to pay, and I just think, well, I've got a lovely family, and I've got, you know, I've never left Bedford Falls, you know, I've got the life I want.
Thanks very much for doing this interview. It's been an absolute pleasure. Sean Black, Proles. Thank you.
Thanks, Trevor.
Cheers.